would like to say sorry that we start a little bit late, but as it's an art center, in this same room, since a long time, there was a theater performances planned this morning for schools and for lunch. So it took a certain time, so we started just with the academic quarter. So sorry again for that delay. We come together here in troubling times, marked by populism, extremism, and Euroscepticism all across our continent. These phenomena making daily news and political discourses show a development of European societies that we thought impossible in the 21st century. The title of this two-day conference, European Angst, reflects the dominant emotion in Europe and the world today. Many of us have the impression that the liberal and open world we have known is in danger. The Brexit was a confirmation of the premonition that the European dream was no longer shared by all of us. The political and social consequences of the civil war in Syria, developments in Turkey, and the Central and European countries put the European values and beliefs to a hard test. We can't even start to imagine the consequences of the victory of Donald Trump in the United States. Yet, can we still see opportunities and possibilities of real change, as does Slavoj Žižek when citing the poet Friedrich Hölderlin, where there is danger, there is also salvation. This weekend, the citizens of two European countries sent out opposite messages. Austria voted for a pro-European president defending European liberal values against an openly fascist candidate. The no in the referendum in Italy could be seen as a no to the pro-European course of Matteo Renzi. And next year there will be elections in France, the Netherlands, Bulgaria, and Germany. Populist and more conservative leaders are kindling the fire of fear. This message of hope and optimism is seldom heard. The initiative of organizing this conference at the heart of Europe, bringing together a variety of partners from all over Europe, is an optimistic signal. There is indeed many defenders of a liberal and open-minded Europe. The enormous interest among audiences shows the timeliness of this event as a platform for discussion and debate. And I would like to thank the Goethe-Institut and all the UNIC members, the European Union National Institute for Culture in Brussels, and all our precious partners from all over Europe in contributing to this. And hope that during these 2 days of discussions with eminent speakers and inspirations, and new energy will emerge to help us to find ways of reinventing the future of Europe. And I hope you will have the opportunity to see the different exhibitions in Bozar, exploring the consequences of war and populism in Europe around the First and the Second World War. Thank you to be here, and I wish you inspiring days at Bozar. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Dujardin. Thank you for having us here, this conference. My name is Sascha Lehnartz. I'm going to be your host for the next 2 days, and it's my great pleasure and privilege to fulfill this duty. We're going to have a conference that's a little bit different than other conferences, because it's supposed to engage more than your usual conferences. We have 40 very active and engaging students from a large number of countries here, not all from Europe, but predominantly European, who have already spent a couple of weeks, months to come up with a manifesto on the topic of European angst and what to do against the rise of populism, extremism, and Euroscepticism in Europe and further beyond. And you're going to see them on stage, and they're going to be participating in the discussions we're going to have here with our panelists. First of all, we're going to have two speeches, opening remarks by the president of Goethe-Institut, Klaus-Dieter Lehmann, and the Nobel Prize winner in literature, Herta Müller. And then we're going to start with our first panel. That's going to be moderated by my dear colleague, Béatrice Delvaux from Le Soir. We're very happy and privileged to have Didier Eribon on the panel, the author probably of the book of the moment, Étoile d'Anse. We're going to have Vladimíra Dvořáková from the Czech Republic, eminent political scholar, and Shermin Langhoff, the director of Gorki Theater in Berlin. I'm going to be very brief because we're on a very tight schedule and we're already behind the tight schedule. So it's my great pleasure to introduce now anyone for the opening remarks.
Meine sehr verehrten Damen, meine Herren, Europas Werden als gemeinsamer Kulturraum, getragen von einer gemeinsamen Verantwortung, ist Teil meiner eigenen Biografie und damit auch meines Denkens und Handelns. Ich gehöre zur sogenannten Nachkriegsgeneration. In Breslau geboren, heute zu Polen gehörend, musste ich meine Heimat verlassen und war Flüchtling im eigenen Land. Aufgewachsen in Westdeutschland, konfrontiert mit der Hinterlassenschaft des NS-Deutschland, ein Land isoliert in der Welt. Deshalb mussten wir, die Nachkriegsgeneration, erst einmal unsere eigene Geschichte reflektieren und uns mit den Schrecknissen des 20. Jahrhunderts auseinandersetzen, bevor wir uns der Zukunft zuwenden konnten. Und eines haben wir dabei gelernt: nie wieder. Natürlich war in einer derart geschlossenen kleinen Welt die Neugier auf die große Welt besonders groß. Als 15-jähriger Schüler überschritt ich das erste Mal die deutsch-französische Grenze. Empfangen wurde ich zunächst mit dem Schimpfwort Bosch. Der Erbfeind Deutschland war in den Köpfen. Kein Wunder. Zur damaligen Zeit war es bei den jungen Leuten üblich, sich per Anhalter zu bewegen. Es gab wenig Autos. Und auch die öffentlichen Verkehrsmittel waren nicht unbedingt gut ausgebaut. So fuhr auch ich, der Bosch, per Anhalter durch Frankreich. Es kam dabei zu vielerlei persönlichen Begegnungen. Begegnungen war das Zauberwort. Denn die persönlichen Kontakte lösten die Klischees auf und erlaubten eine eigene Beurteilung. So lernte ich in den Schulferien Italien und Spanien, Skandinavien und Großbritannien, das damalige Jugoslawien und weitere europäische Länder kennen. Das Interesse beschränkte sich bald nicht mehr nur auf Reisen. Wir beschäftigten uns mit der Literatur der Länder, mit den bildenden Kunst, wir kannten die Filme und ihre Künstler. Europa wurde zu einem kulturellen Projekt, gerade wegen seines Reichtums und seiner Vielfalt der Kulturen. Wir gelangten zur Überzeugung, vielleicht zu optimistisch, aber es war unsere Überzeugung, kein Europäer muss sich in einem europäischen Land als Fremder fühlen. Und mit dem Mauerfall und den offenen Grenzen wurde diese Auffassung auch politisch bestätigt. Europa, so war unser Eindruck, kann aufgrund seiner Diskursfähigkeit, seiner gegenseitigen Anerkennung von Gleichwertigkeit und der Wertschätzung von Vielfalt ein Beispiel für die Zukunft sein. Inzwischen, stehen wir vor Entwicklungen, die uns teil fassungslos machen. Entwicklungen von Gewalt und Abschottung, von Angst und Radikalisierung, von Ressentiments und Feindbildern. Wo ist das Innovationspotenzial Europas? Kapitulieren wir vor der Zukunft aus Angst vor Verlusten, aus Angst vor der Welt, aus Angst vor Veränderungen? Der Zulauf zu Europas neuen Rechten ist ungebrochen. Jüngst hat eine Studie der Bertelsmann Stiftung in 28 Ländern in Europa untersucht, was die treibenden Kräfte sind. Es hat sich gezeigt, der Erfolg der Populisten speist sich vor allem aus der Angst vor der Globalisierung und weniger als vermutet aus der Unterstützung traditioneller Werte. Je niedriger das Bildungsniveau, je geringer das Einkommen und je älter die Menschen sind, desto wahrscheinlicher ist es, dass sie die Globalisierung als Bedrohung wahrnehmen. Die Studie hat auch gezeigt, die Menschen, die am wenigsten persönliche Berührungspunkte mit dem Fremden haben, fürchten es am meisten. Globalisierungskritische Menschen fürchten in erster Linie die Einwanderung. Sie haben wenig Kontakt mit Ausländern, fürchten Migration und äußern häufig ausländerfeindliche Gefühle. Und sie sind skeptischer gegenüber der Politik und gegenüber der Europäischen Union. Populistische und nationalistische Parteien und Bewegungen bekommen Zulauf. Sie gewinnen umso mehr Schwungkraft, je ratloser die etablierten politischen und kulturellen Institutionen sind. Sobald populistische Rhetorik Teil des öffentlichen Diskurses wird, sind die Folgen unvorhersehbar, wie das Referendum über Großbritanniens Austritt aus der Europäischen Union gezeigt hat. Wenige Stunden nach dem Brexit wurde öffentlich, dass seine Befürworter durchaus bewusst mit gefälschten Zahlen gearbeitet haben und auch bewusst Ängste geschürt haben. Die Analyse zeigt auch, dass es weniger die jungen Menschen waren, die sich verführen ließen. Leider haben sie etwas zu wenig von ihrem Wahlrecht Gebrauch gemacht. Ich glaube, die jungen Europäer haben längst gemerkt, dass das Versprechen Europas, die Pluralität, die Offenheit und die Freizügigkeit einer freien Berufswahl, des Wohnortes, der Niederlassungsmöglichkeiten nicht nur eine reizvolle Lebensperspektive ist, sondern genutzt werden kann, sein Leben selbst in die Hand zu nehmen, auch in Notzeiten Optionen zu haben. Dazu müssen sie sich aber auch äußern und bekennen. Weltweit erliegen Menschen der verführerischen Macht der Bilder, die im Netz gekonnt von ihren Machern in Szene gesetzt werden. Und es ist besonders erschreckend zu sehen, wie sehr Angehörige von Minderheiten von populistischen Parolen in Mitleidenschaft gezogen werden. Gleich ob Roma in Ungarn, Flüchtlinge einer sächsischen Kleinstadt oder polnische Arbeiter in Großbritannien. Grund, um ihre körperliche Unversehrtheit zu fürchten, haben sie alle. Wir leben also in schwierigen Zeiten. Weshalb geschieht das jetzt? Und wie gehen wir damit um? Die Konferenz, die bewusst den Titel European Angst trägt, wird sich diesen Fragen nähern, ohne diese Kontroverse zu scheuen. Sie soll nicht noch eine dieser Konferenzen sein, bei der sich wie so oft die ohnehin schon zu europäischen Ideen bekehrten mit dem Unverstand der Andersdenkenden empören. Die Wahlergebnisse der letzten Monate haben uns gezeigt, dass diese Strategien letztlich ins Leere führen. Die Konferenz soll einen Raum öffnen für einen ehrlichen Meinungsaustausch, bei dem auch Verantwortung wahrgenommen wird und auch unangenehme Themen nicht zu kurz kommen. Die Idee, sich nicht in einem liberalen Konsens einzukapseln, sondern auf die Zumutungen der Gegenwart mit populistischen Lösungen zu reagieren, das ist die entsprechend angesagte Thematik. Und ich bin überzeugt, der europäischen Werte sind unsere Basis, um die es sich lohnt, argumentativ zu kämpfen. Europa ist keine unverbindliche Salatschüssel. Sie ist auch kein Schmelztiegel, bei dem Profile und Konturen der einzelnen Länder homogenisiert werden. Für mich ist Europa eher zu vergleichen mit einem Mosaik, gefasst von einer gemeinsamen europäischen Verantwortung und getragen von einem Untergrund aus Rechtsstaatlichkeit und aus Demokratie. Die Europäische Union hat offensichtlich aber noch immer Vermittlungsprobleme im Hinblick auf eine Gemeinschaft. Drei will ich kurz nennen. Die Europäische Union sieht sich selber noch immer zu technokratisch, zu sehr nur als Serviceeinrichtung. Und Jacques Delors hat in seiner oft zitierten Rede von 1992 nicht umsonst gesagt, Europa eine Seele geben. Also die Notwendigkeit einer emotionalen und spirituellen Grundierung. Ohne die ist nach seiner Meinung eine europäische Idee gefährdet. Und dieses Narrativ steht letztlich noch immer aus. Zweitens, die Europäische Union wird in erster Linie als ökonomisches Projekt gesehen. Immer mehr Lebensbereiche werden marktwirtschaftlichen Prinzipien untergeordnet. Auch die Kultur gerät in Gefahr, zunehmend nur dem Nützlichen und dem Gewinnbringenden verpflichtet zu sein. Kultur ist aber ein öffentliches Gut und der Markt kann nicht allein bestimmend sein. Und mein dritter Aspekt, die Europäische Union hat sträflich vernachlässigt, sich zu thematisieren, und zwar frühzeitig zu thematisieren, dass wir in Europa nicht nur auf einer Insel der Glückseligkeit leben, sondern dass wir auch Verpflichtungen gegenüber anderen Regionen in der Welt haben. Schon 2011 hat man die Augen vor den Toten im Mittelmeer verschlossen und auf die große Zahl von Geflüchteten 2015, 2016 war man europäisch überhaupt nicht eingestellt. Begriffe wie Solidarität, Humanität, Anerkennung und auch Respekt kommen im Diskurs über Migration im europäischen Maßstab nicht vor. Um diese Begrifflichkeiten auszuloten und Antworten zu geben, bringt die Konferenz European Angst prominente Autoren, Wissenschaftler, Intellektuelle und Journalisten mit ganz unterschiedlichen Ansichten und Erläuterungsmustern zusammen. Und zu den Teilnehmern zählen neben anderen die Trägerin des Literaturnobelpreises Herta Müller, die den Einführungsvortrag gleich nach mir halten wird, die Philosophen Slava aus Slowenien und Didier Eribon aus Frankreich, der niederländische Soziologe Paul Schäffer, die englisch-türkische Schriftstellerin Elie Schafak, die vielfach ausgezeichnete deutsche Theaterregisseurin und Intendantin Shermin Langhoff, sowie die Journalisten Beppe Severini aus Italien, Lukas Vaceka aus Polen und Martin Ehl aus Tschechien. Und es gibt eine Besonderheit, die wir schon eben in der Anrede von Herrn Lehnartz gehört haben. Die Besonderheit liegt darin, dass eine aktive Gestaltung durch rund 40 Studierende aus ebenso vielen Ländern kontrastieren. Sie wurden in einer öffentlichen Ausschreibung ermittelt und nehmen heute und morgen an Diskussionen teil. Das heißt, bei jedem Diskussionsblock werden 10 von ihnen im Dialog mit den Rednern treten. Und wir sprechen uns davon, dass die etablierten Perspektiven der Politologen, Professorinnen und Kulturschaffenden auf dem Podium ergänzt, vielleicht auch kontrastiert werden durch Wahrnehmungen und Analysen, die noch nicht arriviert, noch nicht abgeschlossen sind und die angesichts der Jugend, derer, die sie einbringen, in die Zukunft weisen. Umgekehrt hoffen wir natürlich auch, dass die Studierenden das, was sie sich während der Konferenz aneignen konnten, was sie dort lernten, was sie aufnehmen, weitertragen. Dass sie darüber mit ihren Kommilitoninnen zu Hause sprechen, es in ihren Netzwerken teilen und auf diese Weise der Konferenz eine besondere Form von Nachhaltigkeit verleihen. Mit dabei sind Teilnehmer und Teilnehmerinnen aus Irland und Zypern, aus Armenien, Mazedonien, aus Polen, den Niederlanden, aus Slowenien und Deutschland und zahlreichen anderen Ländern. Einige davon haben auch Migrationserfahrung. Und die Internationalität ist uns auch deshalb wichtig, weil wir uns sicher sind, dass sich die Entwicklungen in unterschiedlichen europäischen Ländern, besonders den Ost- und Westeuropas, zwar bisweilen gleichen mögen, aber unterschiedliche Ursachen und Hintergründe haben und auch gleich und gleichzeitig ablaufen. Die Studierenden übernehmen außerdem die Aufgabe, und das ist nicht der leichteste Akt, ein Manifest mit ihren Visionen einer besseren europäischen Zukunft zu formulieren, welche sie zum Abschluss von European Angst dann präsentieren werden. Warum veranstaltet ausgerechnet das Goethe-Institut diese Veranstaltung? Seit der Gründung des Instituts 1951 hat sich das Verhältnis der europäischen Staaten zueinander gravierend geändert. Grenzen waren gefallen, durchlässiger geworden, Frieden und Verständigung in weiten Teilen Europas Normalität geworden. Die traditionelle Vermittleraufgabe der Kulturinstitute schien also erfüllt. In den letzten knapp 10 Jahren hat sich diese positive Entwicklung eben nicht gehalten, sondern zum Teil auch rückläufig geworden. Man denke an die Finanz- und Wirtschaftskrise, die Unfähigkeit der Mitgliedstaaten für die Flüchtlingskrise, eine gemeinsame Lösung zu finden, als Symptome einer fundamentalen Krise Europas, die Rückbesinnung auf den Ausgangspunkt der Integration unabdingbar macht. Europa als kulturelles Projekt. Blaise Pascal hat mal den Satz geprägt, Vielfalt, die sich nicht zur Einheit ordnet, ist Verwirrung. Und Einheit, die sich nicht zur Vielfalt gliedert, ist Tyrannei. Und in einigen Ländern Europas erleben wir, dass Vielfalt unerwünscht ist und unterdrückt wird. Und der Einsatz für den Kulturdialog zwischen europäischen und mit außereuropäischen Nachbarn, die Förderung des Konzepts der Mehrsprachigkeit und die fortlaufende kritische Beleuchtung der eigenen Einstellungen und Werte bleiben deshalb die zentralen Aufgaben. Deutschland in der Mitte Europas mit 9 Nachbarländern kommt dabei eine besondere Rolle zu. Und als Kulturinstitut fühlen wir uns mitverantwortlich für den europäischen Kulturraum, für Europa als Bildungs- und Kulturprojekt. Zugleich hat die Initiative für diese Konferenz auch mit einer Frage zu tun, die wir als Goethe-Institut auch an uns selbst stellen. Wie positionieren wir uns, die wir uns den Wert von Austausch, Dialog, Begegnung, Akzeptanz und interkulturellem Miteinander verpflichten, wenn diese Werte so massiv unter Beschuss geraten wie zurzeit? Wenn die Idee einer sich beständig selbst aufklärenden Aufklärung, zu der wir uns selbst aufrufen, auf so wenig Gegenliebe stößt wie im Augenblick, so zu tun, als wäre nichts, ist sicher die denkbar schlechteste Lösung. Nicht zuletzt auch deshalb, weil manche Kollegen, die für andere europäische Kulturinstitute arbeiten, inzwischen auch unter Druck stehen, da ihre Institute umstrukturiert werden, hin zu Repräsentationsplattformen, die nur noch ein positives Bild einer jeweiligen Nationalkultur liefern sollen. Zugleich befinden wir uns in einer überaus glücklichen Position, denn wir erfreuen uns weitgehend politischer Unabhängigkeit. Und das ist für die Glaubwürdigkeit ein entscheidender Ansatz. Das bedeutet, wir können Räume für kritisches Denken öffnen, wir können beides in Frage stellen, zum einen den technokratischen Diskurs derer, die keine Alternative zum neoliberalen Projekt sehen, die Selbstgewissheit der etablierten Politiker, die Hermetik einer EU, die wichtige Entscheidungsprozesse nicht transparent werden lässt. Zum anderen die populistischen Reaktionen darauf, den Hass auf Minderheiten, die Verrohung der öffentlichen Rede, den Chauvinismus. Der Philosoph Didier Eribon, einer der Teilnehmer der Konferenz, legte in seinem autobiografischen Buch Rückkehr nach Reims überzeugend dar, warum sich so viele Menschen in Frankreich vom Front National vertreten fühlen. Er tut dies, ohne sich je bei diesen Menschen oder gar bei der Partei von Marine Le Pen anzugliedern und anzubiedern. In einem Interview mit der Wochenzeitung Die Zeit hat er im Juli Folgendes gesagt. Das Problem ist, dass Europa von einer Klasse regiert wird, die der britische Autor Tariq Ali einmal die extreme Mitte genannt hat. Diese Leute glauben, dass das, was den gut ausgebildeten Menschen in den Metropolen nutzt, automatisch gut für alle ist. Das ist offensichtlich falsch. Es gibt in Europa sehr viele Menschen, die marginalisiert sind, die verzweifelt sind, die über das, was in ihrem Leben vor sich geht, wütend sind, die nicht nur keine Arbeit haben, sondern die sich auch nicht mehr vorstellen können, dass sie jemals wieder einen Job bekommen werden oder dass es ihren Kindern eines Tages besser gehen wird. Als Goethe-Institut sollten wir uns davor hüten, zu glauben, dass das, was den gutgestellten, gebildeten Menschen in den städtischen Zentren nützt, wie von Zauberhand allen nützt. Wir sollten uns der Herausforderung stellen und über unsere eigene Rolle nachdenken, indem wir anerkennen, dass unsere Wertevorstellungen nicht selbstverständlich von allen geteilt werden. Und wir sollten auch im Blick behalten, dass Kultur nicht per se den Werten des Miteinanders und des Austauschs verpflichtet ist. Sie lässt sich sehr wohl auch in den Dienst ausgrenzender, chauvinistischer Programme stellen. Und eine Auseinandersetzung damit und die Selbstbefragung sind nötig. Vielleicht wird an diesem Ausgang nicht das Ergebnis stehen, dass wir wissen, wie wir diejenigen erreichen, die Nuance pro National wählen oder in Debrecen Jobbik. So viel aber ist klar. Besser zu verstehen, warum all dies geschieht, ist die Grundlage für unsere zukünftige Arbeit. Je stärker European Angst Prozesse der Reflexion und der Selbstreflexion auslöst und anstößt, umso eher erreichen wir dieses Verständnis und umso eher finden wir Wege aus Angst und aus der Starre. Mein sehr herzlicher Dank für diese Initiative gilt der Leiterin des Goethe-Instituts in Brüssel und eurer Beauftragten Susanne Höhn, der Programmleiterin Christina Nord und ihrem ganzen Team. Es ist eine großartige Arbeit, die hier im Vorfeld geleistet worden ist. Und wir danken sehr unseren Partnern für die wundervolle Zusammenarbeit. European Movement International, das sich maßgeblich um die Auswahl der Studierenden gekümmert hat, ÖNIC Brussels und ÖNIC Global, Bozar, wo wir heute Gast sein dürfen, das Istituto Italiano di Cultura in Brüssel, das Centre Culturel Tchèque in Brüssel, das polnische Institut Cultural Service of the Embassy of the Republic of Poland in Brüssel, die Alliance Française und Ambassade de France in Belgique und die Evans Foundation als Sponsor von Bozar und schließlich EU-Observer als Medienpartner. Die Konferenz und damit die Diskussion ist eröffnet und ich bedanke mich sehr bei Ihnen für Ihre Aufmerksamkeit. Vielen herzlichen Dank. Herta Müller, die zu Ihnen sprechen wird, und ich würde bitten, dass wir einen kleinen Teil des Protests noch hereinräumen, dass wir alle Herta Müller nicht nur hören, sondern Herta Müller auch sehen.
Freiheit ist etwas, wovor manche Angst haben und andere nicht. An einem Wintertag ging ich mit meiner Mutter 3 Kilometer durch den Schnee ins Nachbardorf, ein Fuchsfell kaufen für einen Mantelkragen. Der Pelzkragen sollte das Weihnachtsgeschenk meiner Mutter sein. Das Fell war ein ganzer Fuchs und es glänzte kupferrot und wie Seide. Es hatte einen Kopf mit Ohren, eine getrocknete Schnauze und an den Füßen die schwarzen getrockneten Pölsterchen der Pfoten mit porzellanweißen Krallen und einen so bauschigen Schwanz, als hier noch der Wind drin. Der Fuchs lebte, nicht mehr im Wald, aber in seiner konservierten Schönheit. Der Jäger hatte rote Haare wie der Fuchs. Das war mir unheimlich. Vielleicht fragte ich ihn deshalb, ob er selbst geschossen hat. Er sagte, auf Füchse schießt man nicht. Füchse gehen in die Falle. Das alles sollte ein Mantelkragen werden. Ich ging noch zur Schule und wollte nicht wie alte Damen einen ganzen Fuchs mit Kopf und Pfoten am Hals, sondern nur ein Stückchen Fell als Kragen. Aber zum Zerschneiden war der Fuchs zu schön. Darum begleitete er mich jahrelang und durfte überall, wo ich wohnte, wie ein Haustier auf dem Fußboden liegen. Eines Tages stieß ich im Vorbeigehen an das Fell und der Schwanz rutschte weg. Er war abgeschnitten. Wochen später war der rechte hintere Fuß abgeschnitten, dann der linke. Und ein paar Monate später nacheinander die vorderen Füße. Der Geheimdienst kam und ging, wie er wollte. Er hinterließ Zeichen, wenn er wollte. Der Wohnungstür sah man nichts an. Ich sollte wissen, dass mir in meiner Wohnung dasselbe passieren kann, wie dem Fuchs. Zu der Zeit arbeitete ich in einer Fabrik und übersetzte die Betriebsanweisungen für Maschinen, die aus Deutschland importiert wurden. Auch im Büro tauchte jetzt alle paar Tage ein Securitate-Hauptmann auf. Er wollte mich als Spitzel anwerben, zuerst mit Schmeicheleien. Und als ich mich weigerte, warf er die Blumenvase an die Wand und drohte. Und sein Abschiedssatz war: Es wird dir noch leid tun. Wir werfen dich ins Wasser. Erst einmal wurde ich dann aus der Fabrik geworfen. Jetzt war ich ein Staatsfeind und arbeitslos. Der Geheimdienst nannte mich bei den nun folgenden Verhören parasitäres Element. Das klang wie Ungeziefer. Derselbe Geheimdienst, der meine Entlassung bewirkte, beschuldigte mich nun dafür und erinnerte mich daran, dass man für Arbeitslosigkeit ins Gefängnis kommen kann. So war das mit den Arbeitsplätzen. Es war wie beim Militär. Jeder musste jeden Morgen antreten beim Staat. Wenn man morgens um 6:30 zur Arbeit kam, spielte über dem Fabrikhof die Marschmusik bis hinauf in den Himmel. Man ging im Takt, ob man wollte oder nicht. Jeder kam an seinem Platz an, die Arbeiter an den Fließbändern und wir Büroleute an den Schreibtischen. Und dann ging man duschen und Haare waschen. Dann wurde Kaffee gekocht, die Fingernägel lackiert, zwischendurch bisschen was gewerkelt und dann war schon Mittagspause mit Marschmusik aus dem Lautsprecher. Viel wichtiger als unsere Produktivität war unsere Anwesenheit. Für diesen Gehorsam gab es vom ersten Arbeitstag bis zur Rente jeden Monat ein Gehalt. Ob etwas produziert wurde oder nicht, spielte keine Rolle. Unsere Maxime in der Fabrik war: Mach heute nicht, was du gestern versäumt hast, denn morgen ist es vielleicht gar nicht mehr nötig. Als ich meiner Mutter die Sache mit dem Fuchs erzählte, waren ihm schon alle 4 Füße abgeschnitten. Meine Mutter fragte: Was wollen die von dir? Ich sagte: Angst. Und das stimmte. Dieses kurze Wort erklärte sich selbst. Denn der ganze Staat war ein Angstgebäude. Es gab die Angstherrscher und das Angstvolk. Jede Diktatur besteht aus denen, die Angst machen und den anderen, die Angst haben. Angstmacher und Angstbeißer. Ich habe immer gedacht, Angst ist das tägliche Werkzeug der Angstmacher und das tägliche Brot der Angstbeißer. So war das damals vor 1989 in ganz Osteuropa. Als sie den verstümmelten Fuchs sah, hatte meine Mutter auch Angst. Angst um mich und Angst um sich selbst. Sie sagte: Du liegst eines Tages tot im Graben. Dafür habe ich dich nicht großgezogen. Und dann schluckte sie, verdrehte die Augen und sagte dazu: Andere applaudieren und verdienen Geld. Und du bringst unsere Familie in Gefahr. Sie hatte eine doppelte Angst. Angst um mich und Angst vor mir. Diese doppelte Angst ist mir im ganzen Land begegnet. Ich bekam nie wieder eine feste Anstellung und wusste nicht, wovon ich leben soll. Ich hatte überhaupt kein Geld. Gelegentlich bekam ich eine befristete Aushilfsstelle in irgendeiner Schule. Von der Straße kommend hörte ich das laute Summen der Stimmen aus dem Lehrerzimmer. Sobald sich die Tür öffnete und im Lehrerzimmer erschien, wurde es still wie in einer Kirche. Sie schauten mich kurz an und dann flüsterten sie. Je mehr Kollegen um mich herum waren, umso deutlicher war ich allein. Wenn ein Schultag zu Ende war, ging ich wie alle zur Bushaltestelle. Niemand wollte mit mir auf der Straße gesehen werden. Ein Teil der Lehrer trödelte und hielt sich weit hinter mir. Und der andere Teil beeilte sich und lief weit vor mir her. Das geschah ohne Absprache, in der Dressur der Angst. Genauso schlimm wie die Bedrohung durch den Staat und seinen Geheimdienst war die Einsamkeit. Ich wurde von den anderen Lehrern gemieden. Ihre doppelte Angst isolierte mich. Sie hatten Angst vor dem Staat und sie hatten Angst vor mir. Ich war eine Gefahr. Ich war ja nur als Aushilfe in der Schule und wunderte mich. Am Ende des Schuljahres wollten mir mehrere Schüler aus verschiedenen Klassen Kaffeebohnen schenken. Es gab keinen Kaffee im Land. Ein Kilo kostete auf dem Schwarzmarkt mehr als ein Monatsgehalt. Ich wies den Kaffee zurück. Das sprach sich herum und andere Lehrer stellten mich zur Rede und fragten mich, wieso ich mich für was Besseres halte. Sie rechneten mit diesem Kaffee und ich machte ihnen das Geschäft kaputt, schlechte Zeugnisse durch Kaffeegeschenke zu verbessern. In diesem und vielen anderen vergleichbaren Momenten musste ich begreifen, dass es nicht nur Angstmacher und Angstbeißer gab. Die sogenannten Kollegen in der Schule und davor die in der Fabrik, ja, die Mehrzahl der Leute in diesem Land waren Angstträger. So wie sie gelernt hatten, ihre eigene Angst zu verwalten, hatten sie auch gelernt, von der Angst der anderen zu profitieren. Sie waren egoistisch, rücksichtslos und machten aus dem Elend, mal ahnungslos, mal schamlos, das Beste. Sie selber glaubten, sie machen sich nur ein glattes Leben und keine Politik. Aber war doppelte Angst wirklich unpolitisch? Ich glaube nicht. Sie verhinderte das politische Denken, das zum Selbstzweifel hätte führen können. Die Verwaltung der Angst war an und für sich vorauseilender Gehorsam. Nur wenn man verfolgt war, galt man als Individuum, weil Individuum ein Schimpfwort war. Wegen Nichtanpassung ans Kollektiv wurde man sogar entlassen. Das Individuelle durfte es nicht geben, nicht einmal in der Kleidung der Leute. In allen Läden hing die Gleichheit der Hässlichkeit. Zwei, drei Modelle in jeder Saison, staubblaue Farben und viereckig und steif und scheußliche, quietschende oder nach Chemie-Derivaten riechende Stoffe. Auf der Straße hat man das gleiche Kleidungsstück hunderte Male gesehen, weil man in den Läden nichts anderes fand. In meinem neu gekauften Kleid bin ich mir alle Tage danach auf der Straße dutzende Male selbst begegnet. Und mir schien, dass sich unsere gleichen Kleider voreinander ein bisschen genieren, und dass sie besser als wir selber wissen, wie schäbig sie aussehen. Die sozialistische Mode war eine Uniform. So schäbig waren auch die Möbel, die Häuser, die Parks, die Straßen. Diktatur war in allen Bereichen des Lebens die Austreibung jeder Schönheit. Schönheit ist eigensinnig und apart und vielfältig. Der Staat schaffte jegliche Vielfalt ab. Aber die meisten Leute wollten unauffällig sein. Ihre verwaltete Angst brauchte Bevormundung. Ich hatte sogar den Eindruck, dass man dafür dankbar war. Das eigene Vorhandensein auf der Welt wurde fast als ein Geschenk des Staates empfunden. Wenn der Sekulist beim Verhör wütend wurde, schrie er: Was glaubst du, wer du bist? Ich sagte, ich bin ein Mensch wie Sie. Darauf sagte er, Das glaubst du. Wir bestimmen, wer du bist. In den ersten Jahren nach der Diktatur hat man in Osteuropa noch gewusst, dass Freiheit konkret ist. Dass jeder Einzelne jetzt eine Rolle spielen darf, dass man ohne Angst denken und reden darf, dass endlich die Grenzen offen sind, dass man reisen kann. Man hat sich gefreut, dass die Straßen repariert werden und die Schaufenster grell sind und dass die eigene Leistung zählt. Aber die Euphorie ist vorbei. Um den individuellen Erfolg herum schleicht auch das individuelle Risiko. Diese Mischung macht nervös. Und man will sich wieder anlehnen. Das Bedürfnis nach Bevormundung stellt sich wieder ein. Es ist wie ein Rückfall, mit dem niemand gerechnet hat. Weder Westeuropa noch die Osteuropäer selbst. Die Hinterlassenschaften der Diktatur sind ein Bündel von Abhängigkeiten. Die neue Freiheit hat diese nur zugedeckt. Sie waren aber nie verschwunden. Die Diktatur ist vorbei, aber die sozialen Synapsen melden sich wieder und machen die osteuropäischen Länder mit ihren jungen Demokratien labil. Aktuelle Umfragen belegen das. In Deutschland, in Sachsen zum Beispiel, wünschen sich 62% der Bevölkerung eine, ich zitiere, starke Partei, in der die Volksgemeinschaft insgesamt verkörpert ist. Zitat Ende. Ist das nicht das Echo der Sozialistischen Einheitspartei? Ist das nicht die bekannte kommode Diktatur? Aber in dieser kommoden Diktatur sind doch so viele zerbrochen. Die wurden von den Angstträgern ignoriert. Und viele haben ihr Leben auf der Flucht riskiert. Über die wurde nie gesprochen. Die größte Gemeinsamkeit in Osteuropa war früher diese doppelte Angst. Und heute ist es die Fremdenfeindlichkeit. Wieder Sachsen als Beispiel. Dort glauben 58%, dass die Bundesrepublik in, ich zitiere, gefährlichem Maß überfremdet sei. Auch die Fremdenfeindlichkeit ist eine Wiederkehr der doppelten Angst. Der Sozialismus hatte das Motto: Proletarier aller Länder, vereinigt euch. Dieser Satz stand auf dem Titelblatt jeder Zeitung und im ganzen Land in den Fabrikhallen über den Köpfen der Arbeiter. Und er war unerträglich verlogen. Ins Ausland durfte man nicht reisen und mit Ausländern im Land nichts zu tun haben. Am Schwarzen Meer gab es für ausländische Touristen Extra-Hotels und Strandabschnitte, die für Rumänen tabu waren. Arabische und griechische Studenten, die ihr Studium in Devisen bezahlen mussten, also eine wichtige Geldquelle waren für den Staat, wohnten in separaten Heimen oder in Hotels, die für rumänische Staatsbürger tabu waren. Nach meiner Entlassung aus der Fabrik warf mir der Geheimdienst bei jedem Verhör Prostitution vor. Für ein parasitäres Element wie mich war das ja eine passende Erfindung. Diese Anschuldigung allein hätte für meine Verhaftung genügt. Aber um seine Erfindung zu genießen, würzte der Vernehmer sie mit einer Prise Rassismus. Er sagte süffisant, meine Freier seien 8 arabische Studenten, die mich mit Strumpfhosen und Kosmetika bezahlen. Als ich sagte, dass ich keinen einzigen arabischen Studenten kenne, meinte er, wenn wir wollen, dann kennst du 20. Du wirst sehen, es wird ein interessanter Prozess. Er betonte, dass es Araber sind, weil die, seiner Meinung nach, für eine Frau das Dreckigste waren. Für eine Verhaftung hätten nämlich auch Rumänen gereicht. In der DDR lebten die vom Staat ins Land geholten vietnamesischen Arbeiter genauso isoliert. Beziehungen mit ihnen wurden von der Stasi verboten. Die Kontrolle ging bis zur Zwangssterilisierung vietnamesischer Frauen und Zwangsabtreibungen oder Ausweisungen schwangerer Frauen. Und die russischen Besatzer durften zwar schalten und walten, wie sie wollten, aber Beziehungen zur Bevölkerung haben durften sie nicht. Und die Bevölkerung keine zu ihnen. Ganz Osteuropa war jahrzehntelang xenophobisch. Es ist die Xenophobie von damals, mit der wir es heute zu tun haben. Die Verachtung der Fremden entstand damals in der Diktatur. Sie wurde von den Regimen organisiert und von der Bevölkerung aus eigener Überzeugung akzeptiert. Genauso wie man Staatsfeinde wie mich gemieden hat, um sie sich nicht in Schwierigkeiten zu bringen, hat man die Ausländer gemieden, um sich nicht in Schwierigkeiten zu bringen. Sowohl die arabischen Studenten als auch die vietnamesischen Arbeiter wurden im Namen einer verlogenen Völkerfreundschaft ins Land geholt. Doch behandelt wurden sie wie Staatsfeinde. Wer Beziehungen zu Ausländern hatte, wurde schnell zum Spion oder zum Verräter erklärt. Das machte ängstlich und vorsichtig. Am einfachsten war es, die Fremden aus eigener Überzeugung zu verachten und ihnen Krankheiten anzudichten oder sie als halbwilde Untermenschen zu dämonisieren. Diese Hochnäsigkeit war schon seinerzeit nichts anderes als Rassismus. Bei den Angstmachern war er zynisches politisches Programm, bei den Angstträgern unbewusste Verlängerung dieses Programms. Heute ist es in Osteuropa nicht viel anders. Deutlich wird es in Ungarn, dass, so der Publizist Paul Lendwey, von Viktor Orban in eine Führerdemokratie verwandelt wurde. Auch Orban spricht von den Flüchtlingen als Fremde, die man sich vom Leibe halten muss, weil sie mit ihren Sitten die ungarische Gesellschaft zerstören würden. Orban wehrt sich mit Gesetzen und politischer Hetze gegen die Aufnahme von 1300 syrischen Flüchtlingen, die mit ihrem nackten Leben aus einem schrecklichen Krieg fliehen mussten. Mit ihren fremden Sitten bedrohen sie die nationale Kultur von 10 Millionen Ungarn angeblich. Gleichzeitig verkauft Orban jedoch unbefristete Aufenthaltserlaubnisse für 360.000 Euro pro Person. Die kann man im Ausland beantragen. Niemand überprüft die Personen und woher sie ihr Vermögen haben. Statt Flüchtlinge holt er sich reiche Familien und zwielichtige Gestalten ins Land. Angeblich hat er schon 18.000 neue Ungarn eingekauft. Ausländer gehören wie seinerzeit bei den Kommunisten für Orban zum Wirtschaftsplan. Und er ist großzügig. Die Antragsteller können ihre Familien mitbringen, sogar die Eltern. Die neuen Ungarn, die anscheinend die einheimischen Ungarn nicht bedrohen, kommen aus China, aus Russland, aus Jemen. Aus Ungarn flohen 1956 nach dem Einmarsch der Sowjets mehr als 200.000 Menschen. Und allein in Österreich blieben 70.000. Unter ihnen auch Paul Lendwey. Trotz dieser historischen Erfahrung von Flucht und Exil unterstützt die Bevölkerung Orbans Fremdenfeindlichkeit. Osteuropa hat in seiner kommunistischen Zeit Flüchtlinge produziert. Niemand hat sie bis heute gezählt und niemand erinnert sich an sie. Nicht einmal die, an die, die auf der Flucht erschossen oder von Grenzhunden zerrissen oder in der Donau ertränkt wurden. Das ist ein blinder Fleck in der Selbstwahrnehmung Osteuropas und wahrscheinlich der Hauptgrund für die Verachtung von heute für das eiskalte Herz. Alle rechtspopulistischen Strömungen in Ost- und Westeuropa erfinden dämonische Szenarien, die Angst machen. Diese Angst sammeln sie ein. Sie sind die heutigen Angstmacher. In Deutschland ist es die AfD, die neue Partei der Angstmacher. Ihre Vorsitzende, übrigens in der DDR sozialisiert, will das Nazi-Wort völkisch wieder neu beleben, wie sie sagt. Und sie warnt vor dem Lumpenproletariat der afro-arabischen Welt, Zitat. Und die AfD hat in Deutschland dort den größten Zuspruch, wo es fast keine Ausländer gibt. Orban hat gesagt, Wahlen muss man nur einmal gewinnen, dann aber richtig. Und so denkt auch Kaczynski. Er schürt Fremdenfeindlichkeit durch rassistische Behauptungen. Er warnt vor gefährlichen Krankheiten, die von syrischen Flüchtlingen eingeschleppt würden. Und er hat sich vorgenommen, aus Polen eine Führerdemokratie in einem katholischen Gottesstaat zu machen. Die Freiheit, hat der große polnische Regisseur Andrzej Wajda einmal gesagt, ist etwas, das manche brauchen und andere nicht. Die Angstträger von früher brauchten sie schon damals nicht. Und heute sind sie die Unterstützer der neuen Angstmacher. Der größte Angstmacher von heute war früher ein kleiner Angstmacher. Putin. Unter Putin ist Russland zu einer riesigen Fälscherwerkstatt verkommen. Aus dieser Werkstatt werden falsche Nachrichten in die Welt geschickt und infame Hetze produziert. Das Ziel ist einfach. Das demokratische Europa soll zerbrechen. Die Populisten laufen Putin hinterher und er ihnen. Den Marxismus hat Putin abgelegt. Er schmiegt sich jetzt religiös. Er bringt auf der Welt dauernd Leute um und zündet in Moskau gerne Kerzen an. Er hat einen Beichtvater und man sieht ihn kaum noch ohne den Patriarchen Kyrill. Sein Kirchenfürst hält die Menschenrechte für ketzerischen Götzendienst. Und wahres Christentum, wie er sagt, bedeutet für ihn, Zitat, freiwillige Selbstversklavung. Und er bewundert Lenin, der aus den Russen Rädchen und Schräubchen einer Staatsmaschine machen wollte. Und er sagt, ein Zitat, ein Knecht Gottes geht nicht wählen, sondern nimmt demutsvoll sein Los an. Als Knecht möchte ich nie wieder leben, auch nicht ohne Wahlen. Nach 1989 konnte ich mir nicht mal im Traum vorstellen, dass die Freiheit wieder in Frage gestellt werden kann und dass es wieder Angstmacher geben wird, die mich zum Angstbeißer machen wollen. Ja, die Freiheit ist etwas, das manche brauchen und andere nicht. Und sie ist etwas, wovor manche Angst haben und andere nicht. Die Freiheit dürfen wir nicht als selbstverständlich betrachten. Sie könnte uns sonst gestohlen werden. Dankeschön.
Thank you very much, Herta Müller, for very, very moving and personal and extremely interesting. Well, it wasn't really a speech tale. And I haven't really understood what my directions are now. I don't know if we're going to continue. Okay, we're going to continue with the next panel. I'm going to ask my colleague Béatrice Delvaux on the stage and the participants Shermin Langhoff, Didier Eribon, and Vladimíra Dvořáková, and the students for the first session that are going to be on this panel as well.
With the help of three very eminent specialists, analysts. I know that you don't want to be presented as a specialist and an analyst, so you will tell us more about your experience. I will first present each of you. So as you can see, we have three speakers today, but we have 11 persons to interview them, so 10 students and myself. And then you will be there. You will have time to ask questions to our panel. The questions you would think I didn't address, or things that you would precisely ask to one of the speakers especially. First of all, I would like to introduce Mrs. Vladimíra Dvořáková. You are a member of the Political Science Department at the University of Economics of Prague. You are an historian, but you specialized in political science. And you specialize in the political transitions to democracy in post-communist countries. And one of your main fields of interest now is corruption. So we will hear from you history and contemporary analysis coming from a person from the Eastern country.
Excuse me.
Then Mrs. Shermin Langhoff. You were born in Turkey, and when you were nine, you flew came to Germany, but with a stop in Greece, in Lesbos, at your grandparents' house. Your parents came to find work in Germany, so we can assume that you know what's the migrant's way. I don't know if it's because of that, but you will explain that to us. It's because of that that you have decided to put migration, migrants, refugees on stage and not in the boats anymore. Because you worked in the film industry, you participated in the movie Gegen die Wand at the time, but then you focused on theater, and in 2008 you founded the Post-Migrant Theater Balkans Namenstrasse in the district of Kreuzberg in Berlin, but then you created a sensation by becoming in 2013 the artistic director of the Gorki Theater in Berlin. Since then, on this stage, you produce place, which put migration, refugees at the center of your program. And what is astonishing, maybe it's a success. You have received a lot of success, you created commotions, people try sometimes to interrupt the things you wanted to show, but you will explain us about your experience and why you decided to express culture in that way. Because I'm asking myself, is to put migration on stage, is it a challenge, a rebellion, a provocation or a remedy? I'm curious to know. Then Mr. Didier Eribon, you're a French sociologist, philosopher, teacher at the University of Amiens. but you are internationally recognized, praised, and considered as very influential. You are well known internationally for your research and publication on the gender and identity issues, but also on the problematic of and the question of the social classes, how it determines the contemporary history and, in fact, the events we are living now. You, as it was said already, you wrote a book, Retour à Reims, which was not an autobiography. It can be read as such, but you don't like it to be presented like that, I think. But it's an analysis through your own experience of the determinism of the structure of the classes and the gender on the life of the people and of a family and of a society. Because you are an intellectual, but born in a working class family. You said that it's the failure of the left who has created the rise of the FN in France, and that I will ask you as a first question after we will have introduced the students who will participate in our debate. So, Sasha, I need you.
Okay, I think the easiest way is probably if you just quickly introduce yourself. They're the first 10 of our 40-something students who are going to participate in the panel. Just quickly say where you're from.
Hello, my name is Aidan Harkin. I'm from Northern Ireland.
Yeah, my name is Nisha O'Fuelan. I'm from Ireland.
Hello, my name is Alisa Zdenica, and I'm from Kosovo.
Hello, my name is Vladislava Mikhailova, and I'm from Bulgaria.
Hi, my name is Breno. I'm from Brazil.
Hello, my name is Muhammad Arslan. I'm from Pakistan, but I'm studying public policy in Germany.
Hello, everyone. My name is Ermin Tek, and I'm from Finland.
My name is Sam Morto. I'm a student in anthropology and special interest in ethnicity and race issues.
As you know, there were chosen on a, there was a general appeal for to them, called for their participation, so they had to answer questions, write a text, I think, and then they were chosen, and it's the purpose to for them to write something, sort of manifesto, after this two-day session, in order to let us know, let the outside know about what they have learned, felt, of what was shocking them during these 2 days. So, how did it come upon us? Extremism, fascism, populism, xenophobia, Islamophobia. This panel is dedicated to analyze things. Solutions are for tomorrow, so we skipped the difficult part maybe. Mr. Eribon, you wrote, or you said your thesis, I think if I'm right, is that the failure of the left has created the rise of the FN. Because you say that in France, the left has betrayed the popular classes which have found a shelter at the FN, at the Front National, and embracing at the same time the Europhobia, xenophobia, Islamophobia, and nationalist feeling of the Front National, of the thesis of the Front National. Can you maybe explain this and tell us if for you the socio-economic reason is the main explanation of what is going on in France, and we will see after that for other parts of Europe.
Well, you know, I wrote that about France, but it, I could have written that about today, Great Britain, Germany, maybe Belgium, the Netherlands, and Hungary, as Herta Müller insisted on the ugly situation with this country. And I'm afraid that what I wrote about France is not only about France, it's what is happening to today in Europe. And that the left-wing parties has not been interested in people's lives, and especially in the people of the working class lives. And you mentioned my book, Retour à Reims, Returning to Reims, or Rückkehr nach Reims.
It's German, yes.
It's just been published in Germany. And in that book, which is not exactly an autobiography, but more what I call self-analysis, or sociological and political self-analysis, and a history of social classes and of politics in France in the past 50 years. I remind that my parents were workers, voted for the Communist Party, used to vote for the Communist Party. For them, it was not only a party for which they voted, it was a whole culture. They were communists, they said, not the Communist Party, but the party. It was a kind of their whole perception of the world were through the discourse of the marked influenced by the discourse of the Communist Party. And then they were considering we the workers, we the left, and now I realize this is what, in part what why I wrote this book, when I realized that my family, my parents, my family, my brothers, and the whole milieu from which in which I was born, are voting for the National Front. So the issue of my book, the main issue is what happened? And we can see it's not only my family, it's a very huge shift from the left to the right, from the working class people in France and in some other countries. And you have to wonder why. And when you see who are the leaders of the left, for example, in France today, bourgeois, technocrats, completely ignoring people's life, completely ignoring people's aspiration, completely ignoring people's existence, that they are only numbers in statistical tableaus. Yeah. And of course, these people, there is no natural link between being a worker and voting for the left. And if you consider that the left do not anymore represent you in the political sphere, you don't vote for the left-wing parties, and you start voting, and then vote at each election, you start voting for another party which claims it represents you. And this is what happened in France today, or in the UK, or in Germany. The far right-wing parties are claiming, pretending, but are claiming that they are the only ones who defend the working class today. And of course, the shift, when I was a kid, my parents, we meant the workers, the bourgeoisie, the oppressors, the exploiters. Today, there is always a we. But we are the French people, mm-hmm. and they, the immigrants and the elites, political elites, which bring them in our country. So if we, what happened is that the left has not been able to give a frame of perception to working class people. So they now vote for the National Front. This is ugly, this is disturbing, but we have to take that into account to understand what is at stake today.
Can you can you give us the moment when it happened, when the left lost its soul or the purpose of what it was created for?
It was in the middle of the 1980s, I would say, because what is happening now has not started as, 2 or 3 years ago. It has started 30 years ago, and I described that in my books 10 years, 15 years before. I was insulted by the members of the Socialist Party, but now they are wondering what happened. They have to read my books. I wrote 10 years ago, 15 years ago, where I explained to them what was being arriving to them. In this book I wrote 15 years ago, I said François Hollande at the head of the Socialist Party will mean Front National at 20% within 10 years. But you imagine François Hollande at the head of the country, as the president of the country, it means more than 20% for the National Front. It would mean, unfortunately, maybe 30-35%. And they are responsible for that. So I have some trouble with the word populism, because we tend all of us to use that word to denounce any attempt to resist what is going on in Europe today, and this neoliberal Europe destroying jobs, destroying lives, destroying the welfare state, the right to decent housing, to healthcare, to education. And if all these rights are dismantled, abolished by this neoliberal politics, that our left-wing parties, as well as the right-wing ones, is advocated, is enforced in our countries, we can understand. I do understand why people vote for the National Front in France. I hate that, but I do understand them. This is for them the only way to be heard.
So, Mrs. Dvorakova, is the neoliberalism the main cause of what is happening to Europe now, with the disarray, putting people in such a disarray that they are trying to find other answers than the liberal answers?
Well, I think that the wave of neoliberalism that started is somehow helped the growth of right-wing extremism and right-wing populism, mainly because of some forms of deregulation. Everybody is against bureaucracy and controlling all the things, but then if you are thinking about, for instance, Panama Papers, if you are thinking about where are the money taken from, how they are used, what is the thing, the policy that's formed, very often is formed only to, again, give someone money, but it's not the purpose, they are not values in the society. And I think that this helped the situation, but in fact, I would say that extremism and populism or the votes for radical parties is something like, if you will say, okay, I have a fever, but fever is only that showing that you are ill. And the growth of radical right-wing parties, populist parties, is showing that there is some illness. And this illness is very difficult how to define. We can say what are the syndromes, but to say where are really the roots of the illness is very difficult. And then to find how to treat it is even more difficult.
Yeah, but Mr. Eribon point a specific cause. He says that there is the left has abandoned the people they were normally fighting for, they were protecting, so that there was a sort of lâcheté cowardness of the left, of the elite that grows and which abandoned the poor people. So what about this explanation, or do you think there is something?
Well, I think we can find it, but when watching Eastern Europe and then speaking about social groups and social strata and about the society, it's something totally different. When started the revolutions of the Year of Miracles, how it is said by Timothy Gerton Ash, in 1989, well, the basic question was how to build capitalism without capitalists and without capital. And it was even asked by Klaus-Dieter, asked that in some of his essays. And you know how it was done? Who could form the market? It was the state who formed the market. And it was the state that was not transformed. It was the communist state that was taken by new political groups. but it was not built. There was, we spoke about democracy building, but there was no building of the state. The state did not fulfill its role. We did the reforms recommended, means like neoliberal reforms, but there was no welfare state. Cuban state was not welfare state. It was state that was occupied by someone and controlled. So there was no building of the state. And there were very, very strong transformation. And you know, we can be very critical to people living in these countries and in their xenophobic and they are accepting these or that. But imagine the situation at the beginning of 90s. Total uncertainty. No one knew what would happen, what would be the further development. In the beginning, there were some ideas that, okay, hard work, education, all these values were accepted. And there are public opinion polls showing that in 1995 in the Czech Republic, this dream that hard work and education will make you successful is going down. The reality was different. Successful were totally different people. Those who were waxing, changing money in the streets during the communist regime. This became the most wealthy, the wealthiest people in the countries. We saw the oligarchs, we saw all these groups that were formed. And not because they were educated and hardworking. Because there were opportunities, because the state, that means politicians, and state apparatus dependent on the politicians, formed business. So how it was formed. And from this we can see a strong uncertainties about the future, low trust into politics. But the same features we can see in Western countries also, lowering of the trust into the politics, feeling that there is no justice. And feeling that they are words, but the content is totally different. Because everybody was using nice words about until today, democracy and freedom and so on.
But is there a responsibility of the politicians, of the European politicians, the European politicians in each country? Or in fact, were they just doing what they could because of the globalization, because of the fact that Europe was going behind? What do you think, Mr. Eribon? Is there a... because it is very difficult today.
No, they are not trying to do what they can do. What they should do is to protect the lives of people against precariousness, against precarity. The precarization of people's lives is something which is overwhelming in Europe now, not only in Europe, of course, but we are dealing with European countries here. So they did not try to help people. They worked hard to destroy the protections, social protections. People up to now were entitled to ask. We saw that in France last spring when there were huge, massive demonstrations against a new law dismantling the Code du Travail. And the protection the workers could count on. And what was the reaction of the socialist, so-called socialist government, was to send riot police, tear gas, police violence. People were severely injured, and a lot of students and workers. How do you think that these people who were beaten by a riot police sent by a socialist government will keep on voting for this socialist party? And now we have to find a way to rethink what is the left, to rethink what is democracy, to rethink what is a social movement, and to rethink what is politics today. And obviously, at least in my country, but if I see the country I'm going to speak in this past few months, what I see is that the distrust that people feel against the politicians is well deserved by this politician. I don't trust him anymore. I'm not a populist. I'm against populism. I'm against nationalism. But now we have to think, what can we do with this distrust, with this revolt, rebellion in Europe, again, through social movements, demonstration in the street, or through the vote during the election. And we have to take that into account and not denounce populists. I know that there is, and Herta Müller stressed that point rightly, there are xenophobia, a huge trend, passion, xenophobic passion today in Europe. And this is what we have to take into account to try to reflect about that. But this is not the only explanation. This is one of the explanations. This is not the only explanation of this, what is called the populist revolt against the elite. The main reason is that people want to be heard and want to be taken into account.
Mm-hmm. Mrs. Langhoff, do you hear better than the politicians or the media that need to be heard? I mean, from your theater, from the Gorki theater in Berlin?
Let me try to give also two thoughts, and even when I'm the specialist for migration with 9 years through Lesbos and so on, and for migrants theater, we don't have enough time, but you just should go on www.gorki, like the Maxim Gorki, .de, not close to Stalin like he was, far away from, and searching for democracy in and outside the theater. And I won't call it migrants that are staging there. I would call it New German Theater or New European Theater. And I think you will face it also if you are there, because we try really to have these topics of class, race, and gender, this triangle in our thinking of topics and in our thinking of reflecting the city on our stage. And the new narrations that we are telling there, especially new narrations, that's our focus, contemporary plays, so which are written or developed with our actors, are really because of the lack that we faced, especially after 9/11 and the anti-Islamic racism. That was a lack that we, especially in the German theater, which is incredibly funded and public funded. We have 348 big state theaters in the land, which are directly funded from the cities. So that's why it's a democratic approach, the Maxim Gorki Theater. It's not a migrant approach. I think it is really important to call this. But beside that, I would say that two exciting things. When Mr. Lehmann mentioned where we are coming from, and we are talking about 60 years before, not very long time, so not a whole human's life today, expecting 65 to 70 years. So I think sometimes we are very ahistoric in the discourses today. And the idea of Europe was born, I don't mean the mythologic one, because then we have to talk about Cassandra, who's coming from the Ida Mountains, where I am from, opposite of Lesbos, where we saw all the childs and human dying in the last years, and not that what we are used to know as high educated people from Lesbos and the poets of Lesbos. So so seeing the complexity is really important, you know, in also seeing each other and telling each other. And I would mention that this ahistoric discussions are really also that where we have to go in and where we have to contextualize that we are not searching for Europe because we are so liberal, because we are so, we like beautiness, if you think on enlightenment, but there is no alternative in facing history, in knowing the complications that you're telling from Eastern parts, geographies, as well as from Western parts and geographies, where we have still the third generation of killed, dispossessed people under us in Berlin and otherwise. So I think this is one very important thing. The other important thing is really, why are we always talking about the populists and about those who are kind of taken by the populists and elected them? The real Eurosceptics that I met were under us. So I met in the, when I came to the theater projects and to culture branch, and no politics and media people, it was not that everybody's like doing fiestas for Europe. And I mean, you can imagine that, you know, the European money union, trade union, how do you call it, is founded on a genocide in Srebrenica in the middle of Europe. I mean, the dissonances that we face since a long, long time as societies, of course I understand them, because if you see that we are talking about values and values and values and don't reflect not only about our colonial history, which worked through slave industry, and where we built very beautiful things that we brought from my home country, the colognes and so on, you know. So even our theater is very neoclassicistic in this sense. So I think we need really the complexity, not to, because this is also my problem, the left is now the guilty. I mean, hello. So what I'm doing is not, for example, identity politics. We were the one who said from the beginning, since 30 years, since neoliberalism, we are talking about Reagan, about Thatcher, about Philo, who is on the way of Thatcher and others. So we don't have to talk only about Trump. So it's a much more longer story. And I think this is really important, that we face that and that we don't do the same right now, to be superficial again, and to now, we liberals are too liberal, or we leftists are too leftist. We have to understand the populists and the right wings, and maybe before we call it in German, you should take this word beside Weltschmerz and Angst. We call it Vorauseilender Gehorsam. Please translate and don't do it.
Question to you, what do you think and what do you hope that culture can bring in the circumstances? Because people don't hope very much for coming from politicians for the moment. A lot of people do think that there will be something happening that will make things change, but what is this thing that is going to happen? So what is doing culture in this time?
I mean, at the beginning we have to say it's a marathon. It was before Trump, it will be after Trump. So I'm coming from Turkey, how you mentioned. I came because of a military coup in the beginning of the 80s with my aunt, who was a communist, one of the five in our small city. So she had to leave, and I've been alone with my grandparents. That's why she took me there. So, and I'm coming from a country which faced every 20th year military coups. I'm facing now a country which is right into Islamofascism, and where me as a leftist, 10 years before, were much too much uncritical with this new movement, where I saw a working class, where I saw this Anatolian working class which came to the main big cities and built up houses overnight, and Erdogan was the one who did the politics to make citizens of them through legalizing their their mobiliaries. And I think we were too kind of hoping after so many military coups and after so many corrupt left and right wing governments, that this multicultural Ottoman-inspired something should be better than military and Kemalism, anyways, it wouldn't. So, and looking on Germany right now, I mean, we have a special position in Europe in different terms. We are not only the one who gave the word Angst to this conference, and we know the historical and the philosophical connections to it, but also the country where it feels stranger than somewhere else, that every day we face burning asylum seeker houses. Mm-hmm. So that's our reality right now in Germany. I don't have another possibility than to open spaces where I have the feeling that the spaces get smaller and smaller. And also all these critics of left, you know, preaching to the converted and all this, I don't accept this. I think it is the day where we have to come together, because the 80% who are not inhuman, who are not racist, are not on the streets. Their voices are not heard that much. But I think especially cultural events like this one, cultural spaces like theaters, are spaces where a common ground, new alliances, of course, which go maybe abroad of this one that we had until now, are needed. And as long as we know from these populists and fascists, they take culture very, very important.
Yeah.
And the first targeted people in Turkey are journalists and artists. So
the same
freedom of speech. So that's why maybe we will become more relevant today.
Mrs. Dvořáková, identity. We have the impression that in Europe, it was something that was said, the importance of identity and the rise of the nationalist feeling. But in a certain way, in maybe not so much in France, but even in Belgium, it was not said at a European level. But since the presence, the heavy presence of Mr. Orban in Hungary, and the heavy weight of those countries, and also of Turkey, in the way the politics is shaped in Europe today, Europe is moving towards a sort of recognition of the fact that identity is somehow important. We had that agreement between the European Commission, the German, Turkey and the other countries, who make the philosophy of Europe move from generosity to protection of identity. So do you think that identity is the main point today in that rise of extremism, and that the Eastern countries have a specific responsibility in that?
Well, identity is a really difficult word to understand. First, we have to say there can be different identities and hierarchical identities. I can be Czech, I can be European. I feel Czechoslovak still today after disintegration of Czechoslovakia. So there can be, you know, many identities you can have, and there it's not necessary to have animosity between them.
But what is the problem?
But then I can have an identity that I'm Czech because I'm not German, no tradition, and I'm Pole because I'm not Russian. In this way, this can be other problem, and these are different types of, well, it's also identity, but have different impacts. But in the moment of uncertainties, if you are not sure of the future, if you have difficulties to adapt, and everybody has difficulties to adapt with the changing world, with the geopolitics and so on. The first identity is that naturally I think, I am Czech. And the politician would like to get the support saying, I am Czech and I will do things for Czechs. You don't need anymore the program. You know, the difference between populism and democracy, both words are in fact derived from people. One from Latin, the other from Greek. So it's the same in some sense. But there is big difference. Populism has a clear definition who is member of the people and who not, who is excluded. Intellectuals, immigrants, someone who is have blue eyes or whatever. Democracy, I understand people as a pluralistic entity. That means everybody, even a criminal, is a part of the people. This is the basic difference. And this we have to take into consideration. And that's why populist appeal is so dangerous. It is not like that I am proud that I'm Czech or I'm proud that I'm Hungarian. That's okay. and you have to be proud, and I think it's necessary to have some patriotism, because you are identified, this is nothing that bad. But in the moment when I'm saying only these people can be Hungarians and the others not, and Hungarians are better than the others, or Czechs are better than the others, in this moment it is dangerous. But in Central and East Europe, the identities are very difficult, and it's national identity and state identity. That's complicating your life. And there is one joke that I will not repeat, but it's a joke based on the story of one person who lived in 20th century, being born in Austro-Hungary, married in Czechoslovakia, his children educated in Hungary, then they lived in Soviet Union, and he died in Ukraine. And the person has never left the city he was born in, Mukachev. And now, what you can have the, what are the, your identities? What is the understanding of the state? And then you can get this feeling and this appeal as saying, well, the good person living in Mukachev is like that, and no one other can be part of that. And this is the reason why it's then very difficult to accept someone who is other. That means.
Would you make an historical comparison with what we are going through today? What is the period in the history that is the most similar to the one we are going through now? We often say it's like the 30s, but...
But, you know, you have mentioned that your parents voted for party. In many countries in Central and East Europe, there are a generation that has never voted for some party because there were no elections. Czechoslovakia had 3 elections before World War II. But Poland, Marshal Pilsudski, Horthy in Hungary, the forms of authoritarian regimes, like similar to what was Franco in Spain and Salazar in Portugal, or whatever. So that this very, and now we can see returning back to this ideologies very much used. It's very strongly based on, mainly in Poland, connection with the Catholic Church. But we see the growth and this altar and throne very much present in many countries. Appreciate mentioning Putin, who is no Marxist all the time with the patriarch Kirill, and it's a part of the legitimation of the state. And we are seeing the growing rose and trying to return back to something that was present here in the 30s. I'm not speaking about Nazism, although there are groups that are Nazi-oriented and neo-Nazi, but I think these are not as strong, and still Europe have its memory, what was it about. But this authoritarian conservative regimes based on nationalism, church, religious, and in this moment going against the other church, and it's stressing this civilization that's based only on Christianity. It's something I'm sometimes asking the question, how Renaissance was possible in Europe? Well, only because there were cases translated from ancient times, translated and brought by Arab. So all these intellectual heritage was in fact somehow mediated to Christianity later.
Mr. Eribon, what did we miss in the identity, with the identity problem? Didn't we see it coming? And who will be now the advocate of the multiculturalism? Who will say against Mr. Orban that no, numbers are not right, numbers of migrants that they give in some political parties are not right? So who is going to be the publicist of the multiculturalism now? It seems to be very difficult.
Yes, it is indeed. I would like to add something to answer what Shermin said. When I put the blame on the left wing, I put the blame on the official institutional governmental left wing, not on the social democracy, exactly. The social, Tony Blair, Gerhard Schroeder, François Mitterrand, François Hollande, and so on. So not on, if the left
The left is Ada Colau in Barcelona, Manuela Carmena in Madrid, Monica Oltra in Valencia, social movements who are fighting for the rights of people. This is the left I like and I support. And of course, this is a kind of left which is not very welcome by the left-wing official parties, especially the social democracy. And well, I was struck to see that when Germany was welcoming nearly 1 million refugees 2 years ago, France left-wing, I'm sorry, socialist party said we can maybe welcome, accept 22,000. And 22,000 France, 22,000 people trying to escape the war, the destruction, the misery of their life. And it was revolting, it was unbearable. So I admire the work that people like Shermin are doing now, for example, in Germany, but also in France. And without support, and even being sued in front of a legal court because they help refugees, and they are convicted because they help refugees.
Yeah, but you know that said that the extremism is rising and populism is happening because we didn't see we were too multicultural.
And in a way, it is true, but. You know, I'm not only a working class son, I'm also a gay man, and I was a gay teenager, a scared gay teenager, because I felt fear. So when people come to tell me today, don't ask right for LGBT people, don't stop the feminist movement, stop the ecologist movement, stop the support to refugees, stop the anti-racist politics and movement, anti-colonialist, and so when I'm asked to shut up, I feel scared, like I was when I was 16. I don't want to shut up. And I'm a gay man, and I will fight for my rights, for the right of LGBT people, for the right of women, rights of women, which, as you know, are threatened, and a threat in Poland, in Spain, in so many countries. And fortunately, there are rebellions, there were a huge rebellion of women in Poland against the attempt to abolish the right to abort, or in Spain a few years ago. So the question is, do we have to choose between the right of women, of refugees, of gays, and so on, and the right of working class people? The left is to fight all these fights and all these struggles. And I don't want to choose. I was demonstrating with workers against the demolition, the dismantlement of the protection, the code du travail. But I demonstrate also with the refugees. I go to the gay pride parade in Paris. And so I don't want to choose one politics versus the other. So a democratic movement, a democratic politics today is a democrat, a politics which takes in account all forms, different forms of domination, of oppression, and to fight maybe together or separately against these dominations. And organize the pluralism. And I'm scared when I see that in France that there is not only a right-wing nationalism, but now a left-wing one. And to fight,
but is it a failure of education?
To fight the right-wing populism, some say, we have to build a left-wing populism, which is obviously grounded in the nation. And I'm not French. I'm French. I'm a French citizen. But I'm happy to be here with you, with my friend in Berlin, with my friend in Barcelona, in everywhere. We have to, you know, the nationalists. They built an far right wing nationalists. They are building now an international of the nationalists. And you can see how Marine Le Pen was so happy to think that the fascist candidate in Austria was expected to be elected. This is an international of fascist and nationalists. And he has not been elected, fortunately, by 45. We are happy when the fascists win only 47% of the votes, and it's not very, that's wonderful. But against this international of far right-wing nationalists, we have to build and to think in terms of an international of left-wing politics, left-wing movements, left-wing solidarities, feminist, gay and lesbian movement, ecologist movement, anti-racist, the support to refugees.
Yeah, but I ask it, you, why didn't you see this identity problem coming or taking such a place? Because it's related to these economic problems, to the...
Yes.
It's serious to say that it's...
I just would like to add, I mean, I think the analysis, we are in the middle of analysis. We have empiric analysis, which Mr. Lehmann already mentioned, very new, from Bertelsmann, Stiftung from Germany, searching in whole Europe. You can have all that analysis, and most of them say the older, the less employed, the less educated, the more possibilities to vote for new fascist retarding right-wing politics. On the other hand, we have, and we don't have to ignore, especially in Germany, the middle of the society, we had this last empiric research of Friedrich Ebert Stiftung, which was called Enthemmte Mitte, so exploding mid, or how would you translate, Mr. Lehnartz, behind you?
Middle ground of the society.
So and so we face also what you mentioned in geographies where we don't have foreigners, those new politics which are going against and which are doing identity politics by themselves, by the way. So the identitaries which you also talked about in your analysis, which we face now also in Berlin, Germany, occupying cultural, historical, important sites. So I think the question is not the right one, sorry, because I think the agenda is the agenda of human rights. So I won't go another way because the most of the population or most of the world is going another way. I have respect from persons like Herta Müller. That's what is my idol. So not to go with authority. So to stay for your values and for the fights. I mean, we don't came here without a history, we don't came here without the fights of generations before us. I think what we have to face is that maybe capitalism and democracy don't function together. Maybe we have to ask us this after 30 years where when you used the word capitalism, you were like in this neoliberal circumstances targeted as okay, old school, you don't have to talk to. Neoliberalism was so fast forward, not only in economics, by the way, also in discussions in culture. So, and I think there is the big issue. We need new regulations, we need politics which are saving the old, retired women, 65 years old in Leipzig and Dresden, who has to look in the trash to find bottles to sell them, to live with it. So, of course, we have to take care about these economic issues, and those are primarily economic issues, and of course we need still the discussion and the development of our values, but please not with the dissonances that we are used to. All of us, especially those who take responsibility and hegemonies in politics, in culture, so Mr. Lehmann is responsible, I am responsible, you are responsible, all those who are also part of cultural hegemony.
Mrs. Dvorakova, and then we ask the students.
Okay, no, I only wanted, when I listened to, I only wanted to ask the question why those people who are really the poorest in the society are very often voting for the wealthiest people and getting them. This is a paradox, like, that supposing that those who are very successful, they use in fact this neoliberal situation to get somewhere, that they will save them. This is
because in some sense the one before was not better, was also corrupt, was also, and you know.
And you can see this problem, but what I'm a little bit afraid of is that we are again returning back from Europe. Why the European Union was formed, or European integration? To gain peace, to prevent the wars. This was the basic value. This was the basic reason. No one is speaking about that now. It's like to have a fair rules how to negotiate between the nations, how to solve the conflicts. No one is speaking now about that. So I think this is really necessary to return back. What was the beginning? Why Europe was born? And then we can ask the questions, and I think they are legitimate to speak about, went it too fast? Are there many differences? Maybe enlargement with Eastern Europe was too much for Europe? And I think these questions are legitimate. We have to think about that, because we need to find where are the real problems to prevent such a big polarization of the countries.
Okay, yeah.
You mentioned that, or Shermin mentioned, I don't remember, that there is a close link between the level of education and the chance to vote for the far right wing. And this is, we can see that in the polls. And so it's the most precarized people, the people who feel they are under threat in their own life. They don't have money to live. And so one of the issues here, or the most important issue in Europe today, not only in Europe, everywhere, but one of the most important issues is education and money for education, for example. And there always were fascist movements in Europe, and especially during period of economic crisis, of course. But now what is the danger if we don't take that into account and try to fight again that through education and the money to the school system? And I'm scared when I heard François Fillon, who will be probably elected as the next president of France, said, well, as soon as I am elected, I will suppress 500,000 position of civil servants. Mm-hmm. And when asked in which field, he said, oh, mainly in education. So we can think that the fascist movement has bright days and bright future in front of
them. Yeah. So, students, so which of you will ask the first question? My name is Adrisa, and I'm from Kosovo. Coming from Kosovo, which intends to be, in the future, hopefully, EU member, I was wondering how these current issues actually affect countries that are outside European Union.
Do you address to somebody
in particular? Generally, whoever can answer. Yeah, it's more about the political.
Well, I just before said that maybe it was too strong enlargement for Europe, and it was difficult to adapt for Europe in it. But it's clear that maybe the procedures have to be somehow changed. Anyway, I think that what is important is to include somehow other countries that are part of European continent in this sense. But my experience is that it's really important also to prepare the negotiations and to prepare that. And again, I'll be maybe saying something that's a paradox. On one side, it took a long time before we entered European Union in 2004. And meanwhile, there were formed all these structures, all these habits, all these things that are not connected with the rule of law, and so on. And then when there was a pressure of European Union, we adapted to do that. We said, okay, we did this stuff, this stuff, this stuff. But only for a moment. It really did not work. We even had to pass the law on civil service. It was interesting. Without law on civil service, forming independent service, you cannot be members of EU. So we passed the law in 2002, but it was not in force. It came to force only in 2014 after a huge adaptation. So, you know, this is very important. If you are taking people into some club, and this I think was underestimated, you have to really think whether they are fulfilling the tasks. What's happened in Oman's constitutional court, what happened in Poland with constitutional court, what happens, attacks against all these basic principles we can see in all Eastern countries. And I think that Europe is not reacting so much on such cases, and this is very, very important. We are taking you into democratic club and behave democratically.
Thank you.
So, many of you have mentioned in your comments the feeling of not being represented. The feeling that many people have that, especially the left, has left them completely unrepresented, has not listened to their voices. And this goes not only to the left, but to government in general. Now, I was wondering what your opinion was on political participation. Can increasing political participation help diminishing the power of populism? If so, what mechanisms do you envisage?
What mechanisms?
How would you?
It sounds like
the question was for me. I'm afraid. You know, I don't have any solutions, unfortunately, but. I would say that, as I mentioned before, to give people more education and to raise the level of education in a country and in Europe would be one of the solutions, because we know that people are more interested in politics, read newspapers, when they are more educated in the sense of they have been in the school system longer. So this is one way, education, and is probably with, of course, the economic politics, the main issue here. And the two are linked. But political participation means also organization. You have to have trade unions. You have to have associations, and not only political parties. Sometimes a new political party appear in the political field, Podemos in Spain, and I do disagree with a lot of things with them, but what they are doing is amazing. I am enthusiastic about what they are trying to do, even if I disagree with their populist and nationalist discourse. But what I can say that to answer the first question is if we try to resist the neoliberal Europe and we are confronted to now, I am against this Europe. I am, but I am in favor of more Europe. More open to people coming from elsewhere, more open to country which has been excluded from the eastern part of Europe. And I want more urban Europe, more Europe, but also a more social, democratic Europe. And Shermin can speak about that much better than I can do. Cultural Europe would be something to build a cultural Europe. After World War II, there were Europe rebuilt itself through international exchanges in the literary avant-garde, cinema, theater, poetry, art, whatever. It was an attempt to undo the borders through the culture. And she doesn't to be called a specialist, but she's at least a specialist of that. And I would say that we, intellectual, literary, artistic, and exchanges are very, very important to enlarge the scope of politics. And sure, because, yeah, because if we say, if we think what is politics, it's not only what political parties consider as politics, it's what we are doing here is eminently politics.
And Breno, I just would like to add that we shouldn't forget, for example, Didier Eribon is reflecting that the representative democracy is a problem also in terms of you give your vote all 4 years and then you don't do any other activism, any civil society work. But those well, as well as the question of participation in general for the citizens is a very luxury question. If you look on millions of Turkish and otherwise backgrounded people living in Germany since about 50 years without the right of election, but the right for taxation. So taxation without representation is a big issue in Europe for especially minorities, ethnic minorities, migrants who came wanted, by the way, by Europe and needed, and where we failed totally, totally, and there was France was further than Germany was, because France was through the revolution, Julia Kristeva mentioned, there was a belonging possibility, a republican, a citoyen possibility. In Germany, we didn't have that blood. You have to be German, or you marry and you make German children non-bastardized. Still, I mean, it's
in France, people who are not citizens in the sense of they don't have the French nationality, even if they are here, have been here for years and years and years, are denied the right
and
to vote.
Even not the communal. I'm not talking about national. So I can't
decide,
my mother can't decide about the playground in our street. Not a communal election right.
We have
Spain since century taxes.
Hi, yes. Thanks for your input so far. It's been very informative. So many of the issues here are essentially economic in nature. I think that's been slightly underplayed so far. And so I'd like to get the opinion of anybody who wants to come in, you know, any of the speakers really.
So can the left offer a viable economic alternative?
Can the left offer an alternative? Can the left offer an economic alternative?
It's also viable.
Which left? There is no one left.
Do you see one in France? Do you see one in coming in France?
In
or?
France, I'm afraid this is not the best example. But I can see there are people who are trying to build alternatives. Reasonable people who are not, I'm a radical, but I know people, I see people who are not radical. For example, Bernie Sanders in the US has a political agenda which we can find very reasonable, and he want to put people together, to think about solidarity and so on. maybe we can disagree, but it's not the issue here. It tries to think what could be left-wing politics in terms of economic politics. In Great Britain, there is Jeremy Corbyn, some people in left-wing people in the Labour Party, and in Spain you have Podemos, who tries to build to elaborate a reflection not only on social issues and daily life issues, but also on broad economic issues. And no country can build something alone. And we have to try to think at the international level. And this is why it seems so important to me that we can meet here all together to reflect from different countries, different backgrounds, different obediences, if I can say so, but to try to reflect together, because no one will do something good in terms of new politics isolated in his own country.
Mrs. Dvořáková.
Well, I'm not sure whether left-wing or right-wing can solve the and have one solution for the problems. I would like to stress that in the situation of globalization, where the world economy is influenced by global processes, and on the other hand, we have nation-state that's responsible for social care, for health care, for all these things, and not getting the money, and seeing the elites, economic elites, political elites that are sending money to Panama, and it's totally not transparent, and it's connected with many things. People are afraid of terrorism. Terror is somehow financed. The basic question here, I'm not an economist, but in my opinion, is that this is a control that's very, very important to have this transparent behavior in the economy, and to have it under some control, because this is something that's limiting the trust, that's making economic problems, making problems with terrorism, that's somehow financed, and you even do not believe whether the people who are very fighting against terrorism do not support some regimes like that.
And I think it's important, again, in this issue, not to decontextualize, because we don't have the first time of laborship. We don't have the worst time of economic situation in Europe. I'm talking about Europe, especially about Germany, where we just faced 5% unemployment, really just 5% unemployment. And what we have for sure, especially in the southern regions of Europe, is the youth and the problem of democracy also. How shall democracy function when you don't have the possibility of participation? It's not just only in terms of the politics, how we see it superficial here, but also to have a work, to have a social security. So we are talking about the material existence, which has to be secure, or which should be secure, and it should be also the social recognition. This is like election and other rights, which should be secure. And then at the end, we come to the individual, maybe, that has possibilities to live his queerness, his life wantings and issues. So, and I think it's not easy to think about economy today. Means to think radical again about economy, and to reflect and to re-ask how the system rolled the last around 30 years, but also before, and how could all these thinkers, there are a few who are thinking about micro organisms, who are thinking about regions, also Europe was thinking about regions when you remember 10 years before. So there are other possibilities, And I think there is not the master plan and the master solutions were not also in history not always the best. So I think every region has to look also for his needs and there should be an exchange about it. We should be more optimistic still. That's what I would call for as long as I see you sitting here and the marathon follows.
So, thank you for your interesting talks. I have a small comment and then a question for you. I think we're missing or losing an important human element: to listen to one another, to look at one another, and see one another. So, and listen to those people who feel marginalized or are marginalized: right wing, left wing, populist, whatever. And to look at their agency and reasoning and their hopes and dreams and aspiration, and not only see them as populist or right wing or left wing, not only talking about them like that. So my question is, how do we listen louder?
Mr. Eribon?
The most difficult question always for me. Thank you. But you know, people are not listened to if they don't try to be listened to, and they have to demonstrate, to organize, to protest, to speak. And we mentioned the elections, for example, I said that the working class people tend now to vote to far right wing parties, but most of them don't vote at all. They have the right to vote. They are, they are registered as voters, but they don't show up to the to vote, and they not because they are not interested. It is a political and collective and deliberate action. I do not vote. So we have to look at that. And this is the way they want to be listened to, by refusing to vote and making clear that they refuse to vote to any candidate here. So how to listen to people whose way of being listened to is to escape the political scene. And here we should, we must think of politics in other terms, because all of them, these people we are talking about, can be member of a trade union, member of an association, are concerned, of course, about their rights, about their lives, and how to build possibilities, venues, institutions, where their organization, where they can speak, where they can speak and be heard. And so
Mr. Eribon, you said that you wrote that the politicians or the people that are at the government or taking the responsibilities don't know is the life of the people, ordinary citizens.
They don't want to know. They don't want to know.
Yeah.
What they say is there is no other possibility. When people demonstrate, they send even the left-wing socialist government send the then the police
So the question is how to reconcile
instead of just proposing a new policy, instead of doing that, start listening. I mean, not voting is also a statement.
Yes, it is a statement. Of course, this is exactly what I said. It is a statement. But I would not advocate a reconciliation. You know, I think politics is resistance, is struggle, is demonstration, is fight for rights, for democracy, for radical democracy. So I don't think I don't think of politics as reconciliation. On the contrary, as a plurality of struggles. And there is no possible reconciliation, because if you want to, all these discourses on reconciliation, we are a nation, it's always, there are losers in the in this after this discourse has been and the losers are always the same: the precarized, the marginalized, the women. And when I heard that the election of Trump is because of LGBT rights, women rights, African American rights, etc., and they should have shut up. It's like those rights were funny things, fantasies of some liberal or left-wing intellectual. No, it's people's life. And there is no reconciliation here. If the reconciliation means that all these people who are fighting for their rights, which means we are fighting to have, to build a more breathable life, a livable life, if all these people are denied the right to speak, so there is no reconciliation. There is.
Shermin Langhoff, no reconciliation? Football politics is not reconciliation?
No, but I'm totally with you, Didier. What I would like to add, because I feel some kind of, you know, there is a Vorwurf in it, that you say we have to listen to them. I don't see them. I am coming by myself from a working class. I used to be precarized 3 years before, as long as I worked freelance. And for Bauhaus, where I earned 2,000 euro brutto. So I'm not talking about people. I am in the middle of these people, grow up in Kreuzberg, etc. So I don't think that we have the problem that we don't listen to them. We have the problem, I face the problem, that we have contrafactic times where I stay and say, we Turkish backgrounded migrants and second, third generation, and you Eastern Germans, we have so much commons. We have to fight together because you don't get any heritage and I don't get any heritage. The social, the cultural capital is in the Western, and there also not for everybody, but for like the half of the people in the Western. So we have a real common issue, economical. We should fight together and we should say, that for economy, for education, for other reasons, we still face in Germany, and that's not, you know, we don't have to wait for populism for that. We still face in Germany, as in other European countries, that education for all, which was a social democratic motto of the 70s, doesn't function. We have still the situation, it is dependent from your parents' economic possibilities, from their social cultural capital, how far you can go. You described it very, very well also in a higher education context. I can tell you to come till there is how you know through many borders. So I think it doesn't help us if we say the one and we. It's much more complex, and that the one and we is made by those populistic services, you know, to make it easy, to make it understandable. You don't have money, you retired 65-year-old woman, because the Syrian refugee gets the money. This is, the, you know, but not because we don't take from concerns like Google 0.005% taxes, not because we earn money with weapons and war, not because. And so the thing is, how do we come to common spaces? How do we come to a talk, to a development? And we shouldn't do the worst thing that we did in the future, because also the leftists did faults a lot. They didn't read Gramsci for a long time. They should read again. But other faults also. But the biggest fault is to fight under each other about issues instead of seeing maybe the common ground and possibility.
A last question coming from the student.
Okay.
Yeah.
I was just, you said something at the very start of your speech, and you just mentioned that the European Union was founded to create peace. And it was also said when we were in a trip of the European Parliament earlier on that there has been no kind of conflicts within a European state ever since its foundation. It's actually lies, it's not true. Because I'm from Ireland, I come from Belfast. In 1971, shortly after the British application of the early 70s to join the EU, they conducted a massacre of 11 civilians in Ballymurphy Estate in West Belfast. The same regiment then went on to Derry City and massacred 14 civilians in a civil rights protest. The state, via the British Army in Ireland and through their quangos and loyalist death squads, they were a section of the community loyal to British rule, who the British Army trained and funded to kill and assassinate Catholic civilians, nationalist civilians, and people who the British believed were a threat. Now that same loyalist quango are the manifestation of far-right fascism in the north of Ireland. So my question is very specifically for the panel, what role does the state play? Because they don't take a passive role, they take an active role in fostering and administering a rise of fascism within their indigenous allies and countries that they've colonized.
It was not a question, it was a statement, a very strong political statement, and it's impressive, but I didn't hear a question in that.
The question is, what can the state do?
I would ask you the question, what do you think Europe should do,
The construct in which this debate has occurred is if that this rise of fascism, this rise of populism is something that manifests itself independently. I personally don't believe so. I think that in many cases across the world, the state is more content to allow the rise of populism and fascism as maybe a centre-right state still stands to benefit from a far-right rise, as then the power structures that exist that oppress gay people, that oppress women, that oppress ethnic minorities, that oppress transgender people. All these oppressions will still exist in whether it's a centre-right, far-right state. So what I'm wondering is that when the state is or becomes aware that these far-right groups appear, my opinion is, and maybe the opinion I wanted to share, is that these groups effectively become allies of what is already a manifestation of extremism within what we consider to be a centrist state, when in reality what we visualize as a centrist state, or a centre-right state, is what harbours and what fosters the opinions of far-right beliefs.
Because it's really too complicated problem. But in some sense, first we have to understand that there is some development in the countries. In the state plays some role, and what to my experience or my understanding of the politics is that it's not very good to liberate someone. It's necessary to do from the society. It's necessary to start from the society and to start the negotiations, and not to suppose that someone will come and bring peace. It means a pressure from others. But it's easy to say that in the societies that are so divided that there can be different methods how to do that. But the most important is the will to be together. And it's very difficult to find and to do any negotiations at the moment when there is no will to live together, when there is really society polarized. And we saw that in post-Yugoslavian states very often, when maybe there could be a lot of rational reasons why to be together, but there was no possibility to be together. And the role of the politicians in such situation would be really to find the ways, and even I would say some reconciliation, to find the methods how to, there were ways how to speak together in Central America. I know that there were some collaborations trying to find that, but it's necessary to go from below. I think it's necessary to go from the society, and there is also the answer for what you said about participation. You want to mention is the responsibility, is the that the individual is to be educated in the sense to accept responsibility, not only for his or her own life, but for the society. I have to have responsibility for the society I'm living in. And this is missing, and this is connected with political participation, and this is also answering your answer, why to speak with others. And I think I do understand how you were speaking about that, because it's really important not to say these are bad guys because they are voting for that and that. But we have to say why. What is the reason? Why to prevent? What are their own ideas and so on to find? Where is that illness I mentioned in the beginning?
Shermin?
There is Wilhelm Heidmeier, who did 25 years before, I can show you all empiric dates of him, researches on these topics. Where nobody talked about right-wing, especially the youth right-wing, and in the mid of 80s, he started with this right-wing research, especially on the young people in Germany. In the mid of 90s, he already started with the Salafistic, Islamistic, fundamentalist youth and the research. And all his researchers, and he has had this approach which was called disintegration approach, where he, all that what we're talking today is written there partway. So, and these papers lay down on Mrs. Angela Merkel's, where we are happy today that she gets 89%. I didn't mention that that the days will come where I will be happy about Merkel's votes. But however, in the circumstances and in the challenges, there are also possible alliances in terms of refugee politics or different things, without mentioning her too much. But to come to the point, I think this is really important that we have the complexity which comes through the Macht, the hegemony, because I mean these documents were laying on her table, and I remember that she was asked, and she said, it's just a communist who has some theories, you know. So it is also, how is science funded? Which professors get places there? How is the education? Not only is it possible to have an education, but also which education do I get? So do I have the chance? I mean, this is why I call myself a German, why I love to live in Germany, because Germany after the Second World War said, after Auschwitz, no culture possible, in the dialectic, of course, I'm talking about Adorno, in the dialectic, without culture, barbarism is there. So, but this means the duty of critical culture, so understanding art as a critical praxis, like politics should be also, and to have responsibility and to take responsibility for society wherever you do that.
Hello, you wanted to add something, Brenda?
Yes, I want.
Okay, if you can give the microphone.
One final, quite abstract, but I think very appropriate question. I'll give a little spoiler and say that in our manifest, we speak very, very strongly for youth empowerment as far as participation goes. And I'll ask you a final question. If you still hope, if you still see hope in the youth as far as fighting extremism goes, or if you're afraid of the next generation?
Sure, because that's a good.
Okay, I have big hope. I have an 18 years old, she became 18 yesterday, Rosa, and yes, I have big hope, because there is the point that the youth has to reflect, not only because they feel it by themselves where they stay, but the dimensions of what will make you thinking and acting, and I have the feeling it's rolled on already.
Bon, je vais passer aux questions de... Sorry. Yeah, no, I...
Okay.
Coming from a psychological background, I think that what we need is a little bit of more optimism, what you mentioned. I think that we as a society are focusing too much on the negative side. Why should we think of this fear as a negative thing? Maybe it's bringing us a message to become together and bring something forward for good. So, the conclusion, So, I will take questions from the audience now, because then you will be frustrated. So, I know.
Okay. One last question.
Okay, there are two more. So, if you give your
Thank you.
I think we all agree on one thing, that populists gain popularity because of fear and anxiety. People vote for them because they fear for their future. And what are political elites doing in Europe? They don't cooperate, they put them on sidelines and say, we will not work with you. For example, Sweden, they're not in. Both conservatives and socialist parties say that we will not enter in government with you. But in Finland, we had elections in 2015. Our populist party, True Finns, or the Finns party, gained 20% of votes. And all other parties formed a right-wing government with True Finns in it. And now they're gaining in opinion polls 10% of popularity. So they have fallen about half, because people have realized that there's no simple answers for complex questions. So my question for you all is that, should we do the same in all Europe? Let's cooperate, let's work together and take them to the government, and maybe people will see that in today's world, we can't offer like simple answers for complex questions. Thanks.
Mrs. Dvořáková?
Political scientists sometimes saying that if the parties that are protest parties, populist parties, are getting, because they are not in power and they have no responsibility and they are getting protest votes, and there's the reason why they are growing. So in some sense, this can be right, but it's also a very dangerous step, because sometimes it was decided to let them show what they can do. Hitler came to power legally. They decided, and a lot of people, even Jaspers, I think, were saying, okay, he will solve our problems with foreign policy, and then we will put him back. Yes, the same was the idea about Mussolini. And he changed the electoral system, and he organized the last election they had for in the next decades. So it is dangerous. It really depends on what is, whether it's only like populist style that you can see in campaign almost in any political party and so on, or whether it's really something that's deeper that can really change the system. And we now witness some of the countries, and I would be really afraid of what's happening in Poland and Hungary. I see the tendencies that, you know, is not clear whether we are not going from that basic democratic principles, we shall see. But the tendencies, like populist appeal, we can see in the Czech Republic, anywhere in any other countries. But, you know, it can be a dangerous situation. Even in Finland, you are able to have it under the control, but there are a lot of optimists supposing. Even in 1946, communists were elected in Czechoslovakia, also in free elections. And,
Do you allow me to give the word to the young man there?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
I think the biggest victim of this ongoing European angst is the Muslim. You know, all the fascist parties in Europe, they tend to describe us as we are some kind of barbarian, terrorist, rapist, and you name it. I mean, from the whole narrative, I was waiting to listen something about that. I mean, what is missing is we are real human beings with passion, with dreams, and we have the same concerns about life, and we want to live a normal life. I mean, we have to face racism and prejudice in street, in the tram, on the airport, you know? So
how you want to dehumanize the other in most cases, which is Muslim.
Who does want to answer this question of identity of origin?
I mean, two inputs, because I just share what you said, and I would ask the same question to mine, knowing that all these populists, the one you want to cooperate with, are mostly anti-Islamic racists. It's, I mean, Trump, incredible what he says about Muslims partly. But we have that issues also in Europe. We don't have to go so far. And I think it's a big question. If you remember, Hannah Arendt wrote 1948 this essay, We Refugees, and her last sentence is that Europe break down through how it behaved to its minorities. I don't know how minority, whether I could translate it, my English is really autodidactic, right? But I think, of course, we have to measure us in this question, especially dehumanizing is a fascistic act of targeting and of making possible. That's what they did, what we did with the Jews in Germany, to dehumanize and to kill them. Because, of course, I ask myself the question, when we have all these discussions in Germany, whether Islam is a part of Germany or not, what will we do when we decide it's not a part of Germany? What will we do then?
There is a huge responsibility with the media here, because when you see the, I'm sorry, when you see the front cover of the magazine or weekly newspapers in France, every week, nearly every day, picturing Muslim as the threat for not only our country, our Europe, the life of people. It's unbearable. It's purely and simply racist, and it's a kind of legitimate racism which would not be accepted about another categories of the population. And when it comes to Muslim people, it's not only it's accepted, but it's welcome. And there is a responsibility of the mainstream media. They are encouraging and nurturing the racism and fascism in a country, in the country in which I live. And I can tell you that I'm not very proud of that, and that I denounce that as many times as I can do. But they don't care, because they are building a kind of there are two friends, the normal one and the, as you said, the barbarian one. But people are here. They are as French as I am, even if they don't have the citizenship. They are in the country, and this is irresponsible, and this is what give food to racism, to fascism, to populism, and to the threat under which we live now in Europe.
Last question is for the young lady.
I know that education has been mentioned a couple of times throughout this discussion, but I think that it is crucial to focus on its importance. I don't want to generalize, but usually people who are not well educated are more prone to being manipulated, usually look at things from one point of view. So my question is, how can we use education in the best possible way? Even what changes can be made so that it can be a tool in order to help us deal with extremism and populism?
I think education is really very important, but it's a problem that sometimes it's supposed, like, it is something like that's private. No, it's society. Society is to develop education because it's important for the future. It's not something that's my own state, it's of the society, and again with this privatization of education and so on, we can see many, many problems, and I work as President of Accreditation Commission, Czech Republic, and know what are these things. But it's not only about universities, it is also about the basic education, and what is important is not to learn facts, and that's in post-communist countries quite often still today, but to have it in context, to learn the context, to find the conditionality, to learn people how to have critical thinking, how to find different information. Today, in fact, when I was young and in communist regime, it was very difficult to get to any information, but we were able to find and to critically read it, everything, because we needed to get to something. But nowadays, there are many information, and I think that everybody, not young people, but also the old people, are not able to find what are the real information, to find that, to have a critical approach to that. And this is important to teach students and pupils.
So I think it will be the final question. So we will first of all thank the panelists, so Shermin Langhoff, Vladimíra Dvořáková, and Didier Eribon. Special thanks to the students who helped me so well to manage the event. So this ends the first panel. Sasha?
Yes, as we told you before, this is an experimental format, and as we've witnessed, our first shortcoming was that we didn't manage to open the floor to the audience, which was an integral part of the plan. But that, I think, is due to the very lively and vivid discussion here and to our students who had a lot of questions. We promise that we will improve during the next panels that you will be able to see tomorrow morning. I think the first one is quite early, so get up early to be here at 8:30 for the panel featuring for the welcome words by Johannes Ebert, the Secretary General of the Goethe-Institut, and Michael Metz-Merz, the President of Uni Global, and then the first panel at 9:30, moderated by Isolde Schari from Austria, if she's caught her plane, she has, okay, so she'll be here. Paul Schaefer from the Netherlands, the sociologist, and Firas Al-Shata via Skype, we hope, from Syria. It's going to be a panel on scapegoating and why racism could gain so much ground, how it feels to be a migrant in contemporary Europe. Thank you very much. You will be able to ask more questions outside. We're going to have a few drinks. And we hope to see you back here tomorrow morning. Thank you. And thank you, Mr. Gold.